I want to welcome you to 10th Church this morning. And I, no doubt, each of us has taken perhaps a very different path on our way here this morning, whether it's been this past week or your whole life. And we come from very different places, very different stories, very different experiences. And among the many things that we get the privilege to do when we gather to worship is to take refuge in a God who is good and everything he does and everything he says. Let me read to you these words from Psalm 71 as we get ready to worship God. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, to which I may continually come. You have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress.
Thank you. Welcome to this, the first Sunday of Advent. If you are visiting with us, you're very warmly welcome today. Let me read to you from Isaiah chapter 64, God's greeting, his call to us, in the words of the prophet who cries out, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, and that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From of old, no one has heard or perceived by the ear, no eye has seen a God besides you, who acts for those who wait for you." Advent's a time of waiting. God is a God who acts for those who wait for him.
Thank you.
pray together using words you'll find in your bulletin. Let's all pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against other people in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. We continue in prayer using a collect for this first Sunday of Advent. Almighty God, give us the grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armor of light, now in the time of this earthly life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Let's pray together. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we continue to worship you in prayer, we ask that you would help us, that you, Lord Jesus, our great high priest, would intercede on our behalf, that you would sanctify our prayers, that you would make them holy and pleasing to our Heavenly Father. And Father, we with confidence come before your throne of grace to pray, to ask you for help, to give you thanks with the knowledge that because of Jesus, you love to hear our prayers even more than we want to come and pray to you. Father, you are not just a tender and dear, gracious Father. You are the creator and the sustainer of all things. You are the Lord. You're the King. You are in charge. There is nothing that happens in this world or in our lives that is a mystery to you or unknown to you or has fallen out contrary to your good and right and perfect design. And yet, Father, we are responsible as your image bearers for rebelling against you. We in our pride and our self-absorption and our arrogance have said no again and again and again. And so, Father, we come to you this morning as sinners in need of grace. And so, Father, we pray that you would use this means of grace as we worship together to remind us again that we are utterly helpless and hopeless apart from the Lord Jesus. We are utterly dependent upon you to do good things in our lives as well as through our lives and through this community of believers. And we pray, Father, not just for this community, but for those who we know and love and encourage and support and pray for who are serving you around the world. We pray for their families. We pray, Father, that you'd be with the marriages, the friendships, the community that they have in various places, sometimes very remote, lonely, even frightening places. We pray, Father, for their friendships with neighbors. We pray for their conversations. We pray, Father, for their ability to serve the destitute, the poor, the downcast, the discouraged, the despairing, the hopeless. Pray that you would give them words of grace, seasoned with salt, that they would be able to communicate the good news to those you have given them to love and to care for. Father, we pray for our own country. We pray for those you have put in authority over us, not just because they are in charge, but because all authority comes from you. And Father, we pray that the authority structures that we benefit from in this country would be authorities that are tender and gracious, they're wise and discerning, that are selfless. Father, we pray that you would establish our authority structures in such a way that your will would be done here on earth as it is in heaven, that we would be able to live quiet and peaceful lives, serving you day to day, in the jobs and places and callings that you have given us for your glory and for the good of our neighbors. Father, we pray for the work of the gospel in this country and in this city and through this church. We pray that you would give us great wisdom, that you would give us courage, you'd give us patience and humility. We ask, Father, that this good news would indeed be good news for our neighbors, that you would give us the opportunities to be able to live life with people in such a way that what you have done throughout history, culminating in Jesus, would be a topic of conversation, that we would so be known and owned by that story, it would simply ooze out of us in various conversations, and especially when we have the opportunity to enter into the heartache and the discouragement or even the hopes and the dreams, the aspirations and the ambitions of those we live with and work with and play with. Father, we pray for our own church family this morning. Pray especially for those in our community who are without work or who don't have enough work. Father, you made work. Work is good. Work is a part of how you have made us and constituted us. We are creatures made for work. It is the primary way in which we can honor and glorify you and serve our neighbors. And there is a sense in which without work, we can often feel less human. And Father, we want to be fully human. We want to be like Jesus. And we pray that you would give these brothers and sisters work, a chance to work with their hands and to serve you, to use their gifts and abilities that you have given them. Father, please hear their prayers and their cries for help. Father, we pray for our families and friendships and individuals in our congregation and marriages and children and brothers and sisters, cousins and nephews. We pray that in every way possible, that your grace would trickle down, that it would be that which characterizes us at every level of our lives, those with respect to those who are in authority over us and those who we have responsibility under us and those who are our equals. Father, we ask also that you would care for this church spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, but even and in particularly this time of the year financially. Father, you own the cattle on a thousand hills. You know what we need, and we pray that you would provide it for us. Father, we also pray for those who are sick, whether due to illness or whether due to age or whether due to injury, whatever the trial might be, we pray for your sustaining grace, for you are the God of all comfort. We pray that you would draw near to us in our suffering, and that through it, you would teach us something of the beauty and also the tragedy of the cross. That as believers in the Lord Jesus, not even our suffering can keep us from you. But in fact, it is a means by which, often mysteriously so to us, a means by which you deepen our love for you. You help us to know more deeply what it means that someone had to die for us and to rise again from the dead. And in looking to Jesus, there is hope that things as they are right now will not always be this way. That you will come back one day and you will wipe away every tear. There will be no more sin. There will be no more suffering, no more sorrow, no more pain. For you will make all things new. And we pray, as we wait, we pray for the grace to wait patiently. We pray, Father, that you would give us the grace to serve you faithfully for your glory, for our good, and for the good of our neighbors. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture reading and our sermon text is from Psalm 95. Which, if you're using the church Bible, can be found on page 499. It's a great psalm about worship, and it also carries a warning. Psalm 95, beginning to read verse 1. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he formed it, and his hands formed this dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as at Meribah, as on the day at Massah in the wilderness, when your fathers put me to the test and put me to the proof, though they had seen my work. For 40 years I loathed that generation and said, they are a people who go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. Therefore I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. May God bless reading of his word to our hearts. If you're visiting today, welcome. We're delighted that you've come and join us. There will be someone at a desk in the narthex back in that corner who will be able to tell you more, or you can use one of the small cards that's in the pew rack in front of you or on the side. And also, those are used for prayer requests. If anyone has one that they'd like the pastoral staff to pray for, we gather weekly for prayer and indeed want to lift up the concerns as well as the joys of your life before God's throne of grace. A number of announcements just as we begin. One is that today at 4:30 is the Bible School Christmas program, when our children put on a special program for us to be able to enjoy and indeed get ready to celebrate the Advent season. So that is at 4:30 up in Fellowship Hall behind us and up the stairs. Also, Praise Makers, Schola Cantorum, and Catechism Club will not be meeting tonight. Partially that's because of the program itself, but parents, please take note. This Friday is the congregational meeting, and I hope that you will be able to come. There's a dinner at 6 o'clock here, and then the meeting will start at 7:30. I will be reading that call, as is proper, but let me give all the announcements first. There are still some volunteers needed for this Saturday for the Angel Tree, both to be as drivers, as well as the following Saturday to be able to help deliver presents to families. So we invite, if you have that, please use the volunteer piece of paper. I can't even use words now, but if you find that, you can indeed let them know. Next week, new and veteran moms are invited to Mom's Meet and Greet on Sunday, December 8th from 9 to 10:30. You can see the bulletin for details. That is not Moms of Veteran, but Veteran Moms. Parish 6 has the opportunity of being able to help with the dinner, the community dinner, which meets next Sunday. Now let me read the call to the meeting for this Saturday. A meeting of the congregation of 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia is called for Friday evening, December 6, 2013, 7:30 p.m., for the purpose of electing elders, deaconesses, and nominating committee members, adopting the outreach budget for 2014, and to hear a report on the funding and planned uses of the 1716 Spruce Street building by order of the session, Bert Fink, clerk. And a meeting of the Corporation of 10th Presbyterian Church will be held as part of the congregational meeting to consider the church ministry and building improvement budgets, to elect trustees, and to transact any other business that may properly come before the meeting. The meeting will be held in the sanctuary at 7:30 p.m. by order of the trustees, Clive Stockdale, chairman.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, how we rejoice that you fulfilled your promise and were born a child who brought not only eternal life, but also one who came to be able to redeem, to be able to show us what it is to live in harmony, in union with our Heavenly Father. Lord, we give you thanks for all that we have come to know in the life of Christ, but most of all, to be able to know of salvation and grace itself. Lord, because of the way you have given to us, we give now of our offerings and of our gifts. We'd ask that you would accept it as a token of our love to you, as well as the desire that you might use it so many others will come to join us in praise and worship of your holy name, for it is in the precious name of Christ that we pray. Amen.
This is the first of a number of canticles that we're going to look at. In fact, you might think, what is a canticle? A canticle is a little song, and a little song for use in worship. And we're looking at a number of these, the first of which is probably the first ever, in the sense that from about the 4th or 5th century AD, this was appointed to be sung in worship. At the time of the Reformation, especially when the Church of England was reformed at that time, this was the only canticle that was appointed for regular use on the Lord's Day, a little song for use by the congregation. It comes from the book of Psalms, of course, which for the majority of the lifetime of the people of God, as long as there have been people of God, nearly for as long, they have used the book of Psalms as their primary source of material for expressing their worship and praise of God. You will find in the book of Psalms something for every mood, every period of your life. Some of the bits of the Psalms we're embarrassed about. For some reason we feel we've got to excuse God for them being in the Bible. I'm thinking, for example, of the imprecatory Psalms. It doesn't immediately come to mind why you would want material that talks about dashing other people's babies against the wall. And presumably there won't be too many times in your life when you feel that that is really what you'd like to do to them, but when you do, those words are in the Bible so that you can understand that God wants to hear from you when you feel like that. In fact, he'd rather you talk to him about it than go out and do it. But there are other psalms. For example, there are psalms in which the psalmist himself seems to be defending himself. He seems, sometimes we think they sound a bit self-righteous. He's saying, Lord, I'm just, please justify me in the eyes of my enemies. Lord, vindicate me in the eyes of those who are against me. And we think, is he full of himself? Is he arrogant? But of course, there are times in life when that is precisely what we should be asking God to do, to act for us, to act on our behalf, and to vindicate our name. But principally, the book of Psalms leads in the direction of praise. In fact, we might say that praise is the ultimate goal of the book of Psalms. If you take them as a whole, there are four books, like the four books of Moses, and the book of Psalms, as you go through them, you will find in bits of them, you will find expressions of praise. But the further on you go, and especially in the last book, or everything that takes away from praise, everything that subverts praise, or diminishes praise, or blots praise because of sin, is decreasing and diminishing until you get to the very last psalm, in which there is no diminishing, there is no blotting, there is nothing holding you back, and everything that has breath, and everything that there is, with no exceptions, everything is engaged in the praise of God, and you find yourself in that last psalm, in heaven, in the presence of God, in the new heavens and new earth, where there is no sin any longer and there is no death any longer, and there is no one silent in expressing their praise of God. Now, this psalm that we're coming to today has a particular purpose. And I think it's helpful as we come to the book of Psalms to remind ourselves that we're dealing with a particular genre of writing. This is not a Pauline epistle, therefore you don't treat a psalm the way you treat a bit of New Testament Pauline material. It isn't even a gospel, it isn't a story, it is poetry. And those of you who did English at school will remember how you deal with poetry. You deal with poetry as poems. Those of you who did science, too bad. You have absolutely no skills that you can bring to the table this morning at all. You will just have to let the rest of us teach you something. I mean, we appreciate your skills. We really do. And those of you who are technological, we really appreciate you as well. But you know, you're no use to us this morning. It's poetry. And it's a particular kind of poetry. The book of Psalms has a key. I think one of the great teachers on the book of Psalms is Dr. Futato of the Reformed Theological College, and he reminds us of seminary. He reminds us to look at the book of Colossians, Colossians 3, for example. Let me read it to you. Don't look it up. That takes time. Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And what we find here is that the word of Christ here is to be found where? It's to be found in the book of Psalms. Of course, the word of Christ can be found elsewhere, but what Paul is saying here is that you can find the word of Christ in the Psalms. And he uses three words here: Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Each of those Greek words is used in the Greek version of the Old Testament and is found in the book of Psalms to describe different kinds of psalms. There are psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And what Paul is saying here is that those are, that book is, it constitutes the word of Christ. That is, it is the word Christ speaks, and it's the word about Christ. It's the word about Christ, and it's the word of Christ. Now, there's an interesting and essential lesson to learn as we come to interpret the book of Psalms. They're written to the covenant people of God, and their focus is the Lord of the covenant. The Lord of the covenant is our God. And yet, very often as we read the Psalms, we hear the voice of the servant of the covenant, as a persecuted king, as a godly and righteous sufferer who's struggling. We hear the servant of the king as he is forsaken by God, and as his garments are gambled over, and as people are mocking him, as his hands and feet are pierced. And this morning, as we come to this psalm, I want you to know that we hear the voice of the servant of the covenant who is encouraging us. He's encouraging us in the midst of the congregation of God's people to praise God and to gather to God and to come to God and to worship God. And the servant of the covenant is who? The servant of the covenant is Jesus. If you go to the book of Hebrews, for example, there you find who our worship leader is. Whenever we gather for worship, who is our great worship leader? It is Jesus. In the midst of the congregation, he says, I will praise you. He is our great worship leader. And this morning, in the psalm that was at the Reformation appointed to be read at the beginning of public worship, Sunday by Sunday, we're being reminded that it is Jesus, the servant of the covenant, who calls his people to come to God in worship. Three things the psalm teaches us. That as we come, that's the key word. Do you notice that? O come, let us sing to the Lord. Again in verse 6, O come, let us worship and bow down. In the flow of the poetry, that is the theme that we see. And the servant of the covenant, the Lord Jesus, invites us to come, that is to approach God's presence, that is to praise God's glory, that is to hear God's voice. Let's look at these. He's inviting us to come, that is to approach God's presence. Oh, come, he says. You know, in that word to come, we hear the voice of the servant of the covenant preaching the gospel to us. This is not what we would expect. Going back to the Garden of Eden, you remember in the Garden of Eden, Adam is placed there in a holy of holies, in a sanctuary, in a shrine, and he's given the word of God, and he's given access to God, and day by day he enjoys the presence of God, and God comes to him and meets with him and talks with him as a friend with a friend, and they walk and they talk in the cool of the day, and there is perfect communion between God and Adam sins. And at the moment Adam sins, God says to him what? Go. He says, go. He banishes him from the garden, banishes him from his presence. And that great majestic creature that we can't even imagine, the cherubim, are posted at the gate, and with frightening authority and drawn swords, they banish us, they keep us, they guard the presence of God. And the great message of the cherubim is, there is no access, there is no coming, there is no approaching God. When later the sanctuary, the tabernacle, and the temple are erected, and the footstool of God is constructed, that box called the Ark of the Covenant, they manufacture these two great cherubim and they put them on the lid of the box as a way of signaling to people, listen, you can't come any which way you want. There is no approach to God except God's prescribed way. You cannot come because God in His holiness says, stay away, stay away. Then we come to these gracious words. The servant of the covenant who took his own blood into the Holy of Holies, who took his own blood of his own sacrifice and sprinkled the mercy seat between the cherubim and indicated that the just judgment of God on sin had been exhausted in himself. He comes to us. He comes to us this morning and he says to us, come, come, approach his presence, come near. Come near. Isn't that amazing? Is that what you've needed to hear this morning? Aware as you've become of your own rebellion against God and indifference to God, you need to hear the Lord Jesus, the servant of the covenant, saying to us as he gathers his people together in the midst of the congregation of his people, using a human voice maybe, but it's Jesus who's saying to us, come, let us sing to God, let us worship God, come. Come, it's a gracious word of the gospel. It's calling us to worship. Worship has two senses in the Bible. There's a sense in which we can say that all of life is worship. When Jonah, a prophet, was on a boat once, he was going for a Mediterranean cruise, and the boat hit some difficulties, and it was being tossed about, and Jonah was fast asleep down in his cabin, and those who were in on deck, they were struggling. They were struggling to stabilize the ship. There was a terrible storm, and they were terrified in the terrible storm. And I think somewhere along the line, they kind of remembered that they'd taken this passenger on, and they went looking for him, and there he was, sound asleep. And they shook him, and they said, who are you? What are you doing? I mean, we're in the middle of a storm here, and it sounds as if all the gods are against us, and here you are. What are you doing here anyway? And he said, I'm a Hebrew. And I worship the one true God, the God of heaven and earth, actually the God who sent this storm. I worship him. And they said, what? You worship him and you're sound asleep while the rest of us are going to hell in a handbasket here in the midst of this storm? It was ironic, wasn't it? What he meant when he said that he worshiped God was not that he went to the tabernacle to the temple or to the synagogue Sunday by Sunday, but he said that, you know, this is the God he worships. This is the God he follows, the God he serves, the God to whom he's given his allegiance and his heart. This God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Israel. This is the God that he follows. And there's a sense in which that's what we do, isn't it? Every day of our lives, wherever we work, whether we're a trash collector or whether we write great academic papers or whether we're technological geniuses or whether we're scientific people who make breakthroughs in the science realm, or we're medical people who are caring for or helping to cure people, whatever we do in our everyday life, we do it as those who worship the Lord. We do everything we do for Him. We do it better because we know Him. We do it with greater enthusiasm because we know Him. We do it with a sense in which whatever we're doing, however unobserved it is by our supervisor, it's being done in the supervision of our God. That's all of life is worship. But in particular in this psalm, you see, it's for public worship. We're called together on the Lord's Day to worship. We're called to come near to God on the Lord's Day, to gather to God. That's what he's saying to us here. Here is the Lord Jesus, the servant of the covenant. Here he is among his congregation. And he's saying, come, come, let's approach God together. Let's come near to God. Oh, yes, you are never away from him. Oh, yes, you can never get away from him. If you go to the end of the universe, you're never away from God. But he is intensely present when his people are present. He is intensely here when his people are here. And he wants to meet with you. So we've come to approach his presence. And we've come, secondly, to praise his glory. John Stott used to say when he was talking about worship, he says, the distinctive thing about Christian worship is twofold. One, it is congregational, and two, it is rational. And you can see the congregational aspect here, can't you? It's in the bunch of lettuces that you find in the text. I thought it was funny, but if you didn't, fine. Let us sing to God. Let us worship God. There they are, a couple of lettuces there. And those lettuces tell us that here we are, this is something we do together. We don't come as isolated individuals. When we gather, we should talk to each other. We should make connections with one another. We're here to do this. This is a together thing that we do as we gather together to God. So we're to come near, congregationally, to God. But we also gather, and there's this rational reason for coming. Do you notice, not only are there the lettuce stuff, but there's the for the. This is the rationale. So we are to come to God for the Lord is a great God. Look at verse 3. And a great King above all gods. That's amazing, isn't it? We should come for reasons. What are the reasons? Well, there are two reasons that he gives. One, because God is a great God. And two, because God is our God. He's a great God. Look at that. Great, that sets him apart. He is exalted. He is the ultimate. He is majestic. He is very high. He is the great God above all gods. You say, I thought there weren't any gods other than God. Well, that's true. But in the world in which the psalmist is writing, every nation round about Israel, all the world believed in multiple gods. And so what he's saying here is, they all have their idea of what God is, but our God is not in the same category as their God, even their idea of God. There is no comparison. It's apples and oranges. You just can't compare them. Actually, in Psalm 96 and verse 5, just in case you were wondering, this is in the same page in my Bible, all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. What's the point of that? It's to say this, all the gods of the nations were made by the people, by the nations. They made them. They got the bit of wood, they got the bit of silver, they got the bit of gold, and they shaped it and formed it, and they made it, and they put it on the shelf, and they worship what they made. What's the difference between their God and our God? They made theirs, our God made us, and he made all things. Isn't that amazing? Doesn't that blow your mind? He is a great God. In fact, he goes on to say, not only that, but he's a great King. A great King above all gods. That word great is almost a technical word in the ancient world for the one who is over all. So you could read, for example, you could read it like this. He is the King of kings. Not only is he the God of gods, he is the King of kings. He is just simply majestic. He is just simply over all and over everything. Notice in verses 4 and 5, everything you can think of is actually in his hand. Whether you think of the depths, or you think of the heights, or you think of everything that you can see, the sea, he made it. His hands formed the sea and the dry land. Well, that more or less accounts for everything you and I can look around at and see. His hands did it. He has them in his hands. He formed them by his hands. They are in his hand. They're nothing to him but the handiwork of God. You see this? He is a great God. But you might think to yourself, he's really big and I'm really small. He is infinite and I'm really finite. He is blisteringly holy and I'm very unholy. But listen to this.
He is our God. Do you see that? Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, our Maker. He's talking to Israel. He's speaking for Israel. Israel is God's chosen people. God chose you. God formed you into a nation. You are His people, His chosen people, His holy nation. He made you. He redeemed you from Egypt. He brought you out by a mighty hand. And He's preserved you. He's your Maker in that sense. Not the Creator, but the Creator of the nation, the Maker of the nation. And He is our God. He has promised to be a God for us. On our side, if our God is for us, who can be against us? Isn't that the kind of God you want? One who's on your side, taking your part, acting on your behalf. And we are the people of His pasture. He is our shepherd. He's our shepherd. He looks out for us. He cares for us. Shepherds, the title shepherd is often used of a king in the ancient world, and the king was meant to look out for his people, care for them, take their side. Very often kings were dictators, and they crushed their people, and they trod them down, and they were oppressive and lorded it over their people. But God doesn't do that. We are the people of His pasture. He leads us out. He looks after us Himself. Himself. We have good reasons to praise God's glory, because He's a great God and He's our God. But there's a third thing we've come to do as we come to worship. And I want you to notice that we're getting closer in here. See? We're invited to approach. Come. Come on. That's what happens at the beginning of the service when the minister, who's not acting on his own behalf, by the way, he's only acting as a voice, he's the puppet, and it's the Lord's word that come to you, and they invite you to come close. God speaks to you first. When you come into the presence of the majesty, when you go to see Queen Elizabeth, don't bother. But if you go to see Queen Elizabeth, and you go, you're received into her presence, the rule is, you wait until she speaks first. I used to say this to our kids, by the way, that whenever I came home, they had to wait till I spoke. But it didn't work. They didn't take that seriously at all. But the queen apparently gets off with it. Whenever you go to see her, she initiates the conversation, because it goes with majesty, you see? It goes with majesty and authority. So here we are. When we gather together, you see, the servant of the covenant, the Lord Jesus, through a puny little instrument, speaks His word first. He breaks a silence. He's saying to you, you might have come in here to this room today and you're thinking, God and me aren't speaking. We've fallen out with each other. God takes the initiative and He talks first. Isn't that great? He speaks first, and He invites you in. He invites you in. And He invites you to speak back, gives you words to say. You sing to Him. You sing praise to Him. You notice, by the way, that when you sing praise to Him, how that praise is to be done. He even tells you how it should be done. It should be done with a joyful noise. Some of you who can't sing very well are glad about that. A joyful noise, and thank God there's those mixed in among us who actually can keep the tune at the same time. A joyful noise with thanksgiving, songs of praise, strong praise. That's usually where I start when I'm picking the hymns for Sunday morning. I want strong praise to begin. But not only that, He draws us closer in, so that we might hear His voice. He has something to say to us. And so the high point of worship is when we do the talking, when we've done our bit, we're quiet, and you notice there's a shift, there's a change here. There's a change of mood in the worship. While we're gathering, as it were, while we're getting into the thing, it's all joyful noise, joyful noise, songs of praise, thanksgiving, da-da-da-da. But now, let us kneel. Let's bow down. Let's hear. Do you see that? Today, if you hear his voice, do you see in public worship there is the gravest and greatest danger that any of us are in throughout the whole of our week? And it's this, that God would speak and we would not hear him. Do you see that? If Jesus, writing to those seven churches in Revelation, do you remember how he finishes? If you have an ear to hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The psalmist goes on to tell the story of a time when God's people did not hear. Or they heard, but they didn't believe. Two occasions. First occasion, about a week, most 2 weeks after the Exodus. Get this. The angel of death has gone through all of Egypt, killed the firstborn son, and the Jews who took the word of God seriously have got off scot-free. I don't like that expression, by the way, scot-free. I think it's an English kind of thing to try and make us look as if we're, you know, mean or something. Anyway, that just came out of nowhere. But there you are. They've just got off scot-free. They're okay. Then they march through the desert. They get to the Red Sea, and the army of Pharaoh is coming behind them. And there's this sea before them. What are they going to do? You know, and then suddenly the sea opens. They get over in dry ground. They get to the other side. The army of Egypt comes out and after them, tearing down upon them the whole might of Egypt, pouring towards them, and suddenly the sea comes back. It drowns and obliterates the army of Pharaoh. Wouldn't you think in that context, you would might to think that your God actually could look after you? But no. No sooner has all of that stuff happened than they're coming to Moses, the leader, and they're saying to Moses, "What have you done? What do you think you're doing? You brought us out of Egypt and you brought us here and we are going to die in the desert because the desert doesn't have wah-wahs every juncture, every little corner and corner to make sure we're okay while we're going on this journey. What are we going to do?" Moses goes to God. He says, "God, they're yours, by the way. What am I going to do about them?" God says to him, "Go strike the rock." He goes, he strikes the rock. The water comes out, you remember, and they're all water. They get, you know, it's like a little wah-wah right there. They get all that they need to sustain them for the next leg of the journey. 40 years later, they do the same thing in a different place. The same exact thing. They get the water all over again. And what's happened? Here's what the writer of the Hebrews says about that. He says that the word was not mixed with faith. They didn't believe God. They didn't believe the word of God. They heard it, but they didn't hear it. They didn't accept that God was in it, that God was there, that God was acting for them, that God would turn up for them. And so the psalmist says, look, when you gather for worship, you're going to hear God. But be sure you hear God. Be sure you hear God. Here's how the writer to the Hebrews picks up this psalm and uses it as part of the exhortation to the church. Listen, he says this, "We are," that is the church, "his house, if indeed we hold fast our confidence," that is our faith, "and our boasting in our hope in him." Because, here's what the Holy Spirit says, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Don't harden your hearts. Verse 12, this is Hebrews 3. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. You can be in the covenant community and have God in your midst, but not have God in your heart. With God's word ringing in your ears, but not touching your heart. In fact, what you can do, it says, apparently is, you can harbor an evil, unbelieving heart that suppresses what you hear. And you are hardened by it. Hardened by it. Because of your rebellious heart. This is the servant of the covenant speaking. But you know the great good news of the gospel is that the servant of the covenant came into the world. And he came into the world as a new, faithful, and true Israel. And when he was hungry in the desert, like they were, he didn't distrust his heavenly Father. And when he was tempted to test or prove God, like they were, that's what they did. He refused to test or prove God. And when he was given the opportunity to look somewhere else other than to God, to another God, as it were, to another divinity, in order to get him out of the situation, he refused. That's what Israel did, but he refused to do so. And his refusal, his faithfulness, his covenant faithfulness is what makes our position this morning so secure. We're coming to this table in a moment. On this table are the signs and symbols, the representation of the work of Christ for his people. He did it all. He's done it all. We come on the basis of his finished work, and we come near to God through him. Father, we pray that this morning, in your grace, you would write your word in our hearts. Keep us, Lord, from hardening ourselves to it, letting it go over us. Perhaps we feel like hardening ourselves to it because we don't like the preacher, or we don't like what's being preached, or we have other struggles in our lives, and frankly, we just are wanting out from under your word. Please spare us from those things, that we would hear you. Even the stones could cry out the word of God to us. And as we gather around this table, we pray that this bread and this wine would ring in our ears with the words of Jesus, and that we would lay hold of him by faith, we pray, in his strong name. Amen.
Thank you.
we invite warmly all those who know and love the Lord Jesus, who are involved in a Bible-believing congregation, have been baptized, to join us at this table. If you're not a Christian person, don't be embarrassed, just to look on and let the elements pass you by as we come to them. This place is the place where Jesus is the host, and we all are all the guests. His words are what make this moment. They create the reality of this moment. We've heard his word, now we see it visibly before our eyes. We feel it tangibly in our hands and in our mouths. We feel that this gospel is not simply for the intellect, but for the whole person. It comes to us. It's delivered to us freely. The body of Christ will share this with you. It will pass from hand to hand. Christ, through his people, is reaching out to you with his presence. And to all who believe, Jesus is really present here, really present to the eyes and ears and lips of faith. He comes to meet you. He comes to meet you in the breaking of the bread and in the drinking of the cup. Our Lord Jesus, the night he was betrayed, took bread, and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you." After supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood." Let's keep the feast together.
Psalm 61, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with a beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to sprout up before all the nations. 2 Corinthians 9:15. Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift.
The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let's drink with thanksgiving. And let's proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen. Christ shall come again. Thanks be to God. We're going to sing together. Number 193, we'll stay seated. While we sing, we'll stand for the final stanza. And while we're doing that, we'll receive an offering. Our deacons and deaconesses are regularly involved with people who have material needs of one kind or another, and this offering goes to support that ministry in the church. Grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.